Please take your seats. Well, good morning, everyone, and welcome to our service of worship here at Dale St Andrews Parish Church. Whether you're a regular with us or a visitor, if this is your first time, if you're joining us online, however you are here with us today, we hope and pray that you feel a part of our time together as we worship God this Sunday. The church news has been on the screens as you've been coming in, and we have a news sheet this morning. There's just a couple of things from that I'd like to draw your attention to today. First is a reminder that our prayer groups are starting back this week. The Monday prayer group will resume tomorrow evening from 7:30, and then our Wednesday group are restarting on Wednesday coming, the 20th of April, at 1 o'clock. Both groups meet in the prayer room just off to the side of the sanctuary. So if you are able to come to either of these, then please do so, because it's a good time of fellowship. But prayer is also important because it undergirds everything that we do as a church family. So please do remember that, and if you are able to, you'd be welcome to come along. Next Sunday, we have our next installment of Messy Church, which I hope that folks are looking forward to. I know I am. I've been asked to say that if anyone is looking to register for Messy Church, if they could please do it by Wednesday, the 20th of April. That's this Wednesday coming. And the reason that I've been asked to announce that is that if you don't register by this Wednesday, you won't get your tea. So very important, if you want fed, please do register for Messy Church by this Wednesday. And please highlight this as well to any friends or family that you know that might benefit from coming along and being part of Messy. Those are the only announcements I want to draw our attention to. The rest is as in the print. Throughout the Gospels and the New Testament, we read of many promises that Jesus gave to his followers, that wherever they are, and whatever they do, he is with them. We believe that Jesus is present and here with us today as we gather to worship him. And so as we come to proclaim our belief in the presence of God through Jesus Christ, let us stand and sing our first hymn. It's a classic, and it's one that I certainly enjoy. Hymn number 352 from the church hymnary, Oh, for a Thousand Tongues to Sing. After the introduction, we'll stand and sing together.
Thank you.
You need a fair bit of puff to get through that one, don't you? But it's a good hymn, giving praise to our God. Let us continue to praise God now as we come before him in prayer. Let us pray together. Lord Jesus Christ, we gather here this day out of love and devotion for you. We are here worshiping in this place because each of us has sensed you calling out to us, calling us back to God, our Father in heaven. We ask and pray that our time together would be truly honoring to you, and that we would worship you with all of our hearts, all of our soul, all of our mind, and all of our strength. Lord Jesus Christ, sometimes we are so busy in life that we fail to find you beside us. We walk on throughout life focusing on our questions and our thoughts and desires, and we do not take an opportunity to realize that you are with us. Stay with us, Jesus Christ. Reach out toward us and invite us to pause and meet with you. As we look at our lives and our world around us, we are sometimes too anxious to share what really troubles us. We hold before you our thoughts, our doubts, our fears, our questions. We know that you walk with us in life, and so we pray that we would be open to you this day. Meet us, Lord Jesus, as you did your disciples on the road to Emmaus. Guide us on the path toward our destination and renew our strength as we continue to walk with you. Open our eyes, Lord God, to see the signs of Jesus' presence around us. Open our hearts so that we may receive your peace and love. And empower us through the sharing of our worship this day that we might pass on to others the grace and the forgiveness and the love that you have shared with us. We pray this and all things in the name of Jesus Christ, who is our wonderful Lord and true Savior. Amen. We continue to worship God by singing another hymn, hymn number 442, Blessing and Honor, Glory and Power. We have sung this one before, but it is one which may not be as familiar to us, so we're just going to go straight into this one, but we're going to sing the whole thing through twice. So if you worry about not picking it up the first time, don't worry, you'll get it the second time round. Let us stand and sing, Blessing and Honor, Glory and Power. We are continuing in our theme of looking at passages which tell us something about the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. And this morning we're going to turn to the Gospel of Luke. Luke chapter 24, reading from verses 13 through to 36, a story which I'm sure will be familiar to most of us who have been around church for a long time, the story of the road to Emmaus. Let us hear the word of God. Now that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. They were talking with each other about everything that had happened. As they talked and discussed these things with each other, Jesus himself came up and walked along with them, but they were kept from recognizing him. He asked them, "What are you discussing together as you walk along?" They stood still, their faces downcast. One of them, named Cleopas, asked him, "Are you the only one visiting Jerusalem who does not know the things that have happened there in these days?" "What things?" he asked. "About Jesus of Nazareth," they replied. "He was a prophet, powerful in word and deed before God and all the people. The chief priests and our rulers handed him over to be sentenced to death, and they crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one who was going to redeem Israel. And what is more, it is the third day since all this took place. In addition, some of our women amazed us. They went to the tomb early this morning, but didn't find his body. They came and told us that they had seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. Then some of our companions went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but they did not see Jesus." He said to them, "How foolish you are. And how slow to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Did not the Messiah have to suffer these things and then enter his glory?" And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning himself. As they approached the village to which they were going, Jesus continued on as if he was going further. But they urged him strongly, "Stay with us, for it is nearly evening. The day is almost over." So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and began to give it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he disappeared from their sight. They asked each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us when he talked with us on the road and opened the scriptures to us?" They got up and returned at once to Jerusalem. There they found the 11 and those with them assembled together and saying, "It is true, the Lord is risen and has appeared to Simon." Then the two told what happened on the way and how Jesus was recognized by them when he broke bread. While they were still talking about this, Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." Amen, and may God add his blessing to the reading of his holy word to us this day. We continue to sing to God's praises this morning, this time with hymn number 426, "All Heaven Declares the Glory of the Risen Lord." We'll stand and sing together.
Glory of the risen Lord, who can compare?
Over the last couple of months, I have been attending something called spiritual direction or spiritual accompaniment. This involves me meeting up with someone who's been trained to help me talk through certain aspects of my faith and help me to think more about my relationship with God. I've done this for a couple of reasons. Firstly, because I wanted to explore my faith to a deeper level and I felt that that was an appropriate way to do it. But the other reason is that actually training for ministry does nothing for your faith. As you train for ministry, there's a huge amount of emphasis on theology, on the skills you need to have to be a minister, on all these things. But there's very, very little emphasis on your own personal faith in God. Which means that if I want my faith to flourish, it is my responsibility to look after it. There's nothing in the training that will do this for me. And I share this with you for a couple of reasons. The first is to kind of let you know that just because I'm a trainee minister, that doesn't mean that my faith is any better or deeper or whatever than yours. I still have struggles, I still have questions, I still have doubts, and I, like everyone else who has faith in Jesus Christ, have to spend time working these things through. The difference is that my faith is vital for me to be a Christian leader. If my faith hits the rocks for whatever reason, it's much more difficult for me to fulfill my calling and my duty to God to lead his people. And so I look after my faith. I cultivate my faith. But I also share this with you because I truly believe that all of us, no matter where we are on a journey of faith. We're on a journey. Our faith is not something which is static. It is not something which is unmoving. It is something that develops and changes over time, ideally deepens and gets stronger. And so all of us are on this journey of faith. And although the actual details of that journey will be different for every one of us, for we are all individuals, I would suggest that the underlying pattern of the journey of faith or the journey to faith is very, very similar. And I think that the Emmaus Road story illustrates very well what this journey looks like. So where do we begin on our journey of faith? Very often, I think we begin with a crisis. For the disciples in the Emmaus Road story, the crisis that they had was that Jesus was dead. Jesus had been put to death. They had expected Jesus to be the one who would come, and it says it in Scripture for us, to redeem Israel. They had expected great things from their leader, and yet he was put to death, and to them that seemed like defeat. Seemed like they had lost because their leader was dead. That was their crisis. In the journey of faith, those of us who already have faith and are on that journey, the crisis could be something like a change in life circumstances. It could be a challenge from a friend or a loved one or even from the world. But it is something that we would call a test to our faith. Something that causes us to start questioning and perhaps doubting. That's the kind of crisis, I imagine. If it's the journey to faith, so someone that does not yet have faith but is making steps toward faith, the crisis could be anything that causes you to question what you believe. It could be a worldwide event. I was reading in the news this morning that there are countries across the world have been hit by earthquakes. Natural disasters are often things that cause people to start questioning. Again, it could be a change in personal circumstances, but ultimately it comes down to something happens to you that causes you to start questioning beliefs that you may have held for a very, very long time. And so that is the beginning of this journey. It's a crisis. And I know that we think of a crisis as being something catastrophic, something that has, you know, completely blown everything apart, but it doesn't need to be that. One person's crisis could be another person's walk in the park. A crisis is a very personal thing. So whatever it is that happens to you, it causes you to start questioning what you've always held to be true. And so we start from a crisis, and then we move to what I have called an encounter. An encounter. For the disciples in the story, their crisis was that Jesus had died, challenging their belief that he would come to redeem Israel, and they have a chance encounter with a stranger on the road. They don't know who this person is, and they share the details of their crisis with this unknown man. And after listening to them, he responds, "How foolish you are! How slow to believe all that the prophets have spoken! Did not the Messiah have to suffer these things and then enter his glory?" And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning himself. And so in this encounter with the stranger, he sees where their crisis is coming from. He understands why they're feeling the way they are. And what this stranger is able to do is talk them through that crisis. He's able to talk to them about why they're feeling the way that they are, but he's also able to help put their beliefs right. It says that this stranger talked them through all of the scriptures. That would be all of our Old Testament, starting with Genesis, working all the way through to the prophets, Malachi and whatever. He took the whole of Scripture and he explained to the disciples that the Messiah didn't come to save Israel from suffering. He didn't come to save the world from suffering. He came to save the world through suffering. And so this chance encounter helps the disciples work through their crisis. What encounters might we have? We can have all sorts of encounters in our daily lives. It could be a chance encounter with someone on the street, a person who talks to you. It could be meeting a friend for a coffee. It could be something you read. It could be something you hear. It could be through the words of Scripture or prayer if you're a believer. But there's always some sort of encounter which can help us work through our crisis. But one of the things that I think is key in both the Bible story and in our story of life, I don't think we always realize that God is at work when he is. You see, the disciples, when they had this encounter with the stranger, they did not recognize Jesus right away. They didn't see him. And so for us, sometimes when we have these chance encounters, when we have these opportunities to work through whatever crisis we're facing, we don't always realize that God is at work. But if we believe that God is a sovereign God, in other words, that God is in control of all things, then nothing that happens to us comes as a surprise to God. God knows all things, so when something happens in our lives, God knew it was going to happen before it did. This can give us confidence that when we face a crisis, God knows it's happening. God knows it's happening. And rather than divert the crisis from us, some people say, oh, why has God allowed me to suffer in this way? Well, do you know, it's through suffering, it's through a crisis, it's through a difficulty that actually we grow as people. I have found my faith growing more through the difficult times in my life than the good. Because when life is good and all is rosy, I become complacent. I start to think, I don't need God. I can do this on my own. And then it takes a crisis to bring me back and remind me, actually, I cannot walk this life alone. I need God with me. And so that is why God can allow a crisis to happen. So rather than diverting it, God ensures that he provides a way for us to be able to walk through it. He provides a way for us to be able to deal with whatever comes our way. And so even when we don't realize it at the time, and if you're in the midst of a crisis, it can be hard to see God. It can be hard because you're so caught up in the moment. But God is there, and God is at work behind the scenes, even when we can't see it. And so the journey of faith, the journey to faith that we all experience begins with this crisis that causes us to question what we believe, causes us to have to reevaluate things. And then as we work this through with people or on our own, God is with us and helps us work this through, although we may not know that God is present during that time. But the wonderful thing about God is that he doesn't stay hidden. He doesn't stay hidden. In our Bible story this morning, the strange man that the disciples didn't recognize looked as though he was going to continue walking on his way. But they were good Middle Eastern people, and hospitality is one of the key things that you do if you're from that part of the world. So they insist upon this man, come in, it's late, it's getting dark, stay with us, share our food, let us look after you. So the stranger comes in to their home. And then they're sharing a meal, and in words that are very reminiscent of the Last Supper, we read, when he was at table with them, he took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and began to give it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he disappeared from their sight. As they were at the table together, Jesus revealed himself to the disciples. He revealed that it had been him that had walked with them as they thought through and worked out the problems that they were having. And I think that that is a very apt image for us. Because very often when we are working through a crisis, we may not see Jesus. But when we come out the other side and we look back and we reflect, we see him there. We see him there having walked with us. And it's an encouraging thing. But I also want to encourage you this morning that if you are resonating with the crisis part of the story, if you think you are the person who is at the beginning of this journey, who God is far from you and is not with you, well, I want to encourage you to take a moment and stop in your life and look around and pray and ask God, where are you in this? Because God doesn't hide himself from us. And if we look for him, we will find him. I'm put in mind of a poem which I'm sure will be familiar to a lot of us, Footprints in the Sand by Mary Stevenson. We probably overquote this. It's not something drawn from the pages of Scripture, but it's very apt in capturing what we are thinking about today. In this poem, it's written, I think, from Mary Stevenson's point of view. She has a dream where she's walking along a beach with God, and the footprints in the sand represent her life. And then, you know, at most points in her life, there are two sets of footprints, her footprints and God's footprints. But when she looks at the times which were her very lowest and saddest, she sees only one set of footprints. She writes, "This really troubled me, so I asked the Lord about it. Lord, you said once I decided to follow you, you'd walk with me all the way. But I noticed that during the saddest and most troublesome times of my life, there was only one set of footprints. I don't understand why, when I needed you the most, you would leave me." The Lord whispered in reply, "My child, I love you and will never leave you, never ever during your trials and testings. When you saw only one set of footprints, it was then that I carried you. It was then that I carried you." That is what God says to us this day as we face the trials of life. "My child, I'm carrying you." It's a wonderful image of a loving God who takes care of his children. What happens then when we have this realization that we have truly had an encounter with the risen Jesus who has helped us through our crisis? In the story, the disciples say to one another, "Were our hearts not burning within us when he talked with us on the road and opened Scripture to us?" They got up and returned at once to Jerusalem, verses 32 and 33. When the disciples realized it was Jesus that had been with them all along, two things happened to them. First, they remembered how their hearts burned when Jesus spoke with them. And so something about Jesus' explanation of the Scripture stirred them on a very deep level. It resonated with them. It connected with them on the deepest level. And then in the middle of the night, we know it was nighttime because they had asked Jesus in to stay with them because it was getting late. In the middle of the night, they got up, they left, and they returned to Jerusalem because they were desperate to tell other people. They were desperate to share that they had had an encounter with the risen Jesus Christ. And so I wonder if we have ever had that experience. I wonder if we have ever experienced the heart that burns when we have an encounter with Jesus, or the desire to go and to tell other people. When we talk about our hearts burning for God, it's a poetic image. It's one that is very difficult to put into words. The best I could come up with was intense assuredness. I'm not even sure I know what that means, and I came up with it, but we all need to think of our own way of understanding what it means to have a heart that burns for God. But in essence, it comes back to what I prayed as part of our opening prayer, that we devote ourselves to God wholly, all of our heart, mind, soul, and strength. We cultivate a faith in him through Scripture and prayer. And then we share that faith with other people. We reach out to them. We tell them that they too are loved and can have an encounter with the risen Lord Jesus Christ. And ultimately what it comes down to is us as believers looking for ways in which we can participate in the building of God's kingdom here on earth. We have a calling, all of us who are Christians, a calling from Christ that says, be the signpost that points forward to the new creation. Be the place where people can come and have their hearts healed and their sadnesses comforted. Be the people that share the love of God with others. That's what the kingdom of God is all about. That's what it will be in the final days when we read in Revelation about a place where there will be no more crying or pain or sadness, for these things have passed away. But we as Christians have a duty to make the future kingdom of God felt in the present so that people know what it's going to be like. And so this is why the resurrection is so important. The resurrection of Jesus is the foundation for all that we do as Christians in reaching out to other people, and it's the fuel that keeps the fires of our faith and our hearts burning as we work for him in this world. This is the difference that an encounter with the risen Lord makes in our lives. He helps us work through the crisis. He helps us to have a deep foundation of our faith. He's alive. Jesus comes to us not as a savior in the grave, but as a savior who is alive. And so in the journeys this morning, the journey of the Emmaus Road, the journey of faith and the journey to faith, I think we can say that they follow a similar pattern. They begin with some sort of crisis that forces us to start thinking things through. As we move through this crisis, we get help, and the help is usually from God, although we may not see God in the situation in the immediate, in the immediacy of it. But afterwards, there is a recognition that the risen Lord Jesus was walking with us through all these things. And this then gives us encouragement to go and tell other people, this is how an encounter with the risen Lord Jesus changed me. You can have this encounter too. So I ask you, what stage of that journey are you at today? Where do you see yourself in the journey that we have described this morning? Wherever you are, whatever part of that journey you see yourself in, I want to encourage you to take a moment to stop, to look around you and to realize that the risen Jesus is with you today. And when you recognize him, when you find him, in the midst of your life, let him say to you what he said to his disciples in verse 36. Peace be with you. Let us pray. Risen Lord Jesus, we give thanks that you truly are present and with us today. You walk with us through life. You promised when you left this world and returned to heaven that you would be with us always, even to the end of the age. And so we ask and pray, risen Lord, that you would help us to find you and see you in our lives. Give us the encouragement and the strength that comes from an encounter with the risen Lord Jesus. And then help us to go and to share that with other people and encourage them to have that same encounter, that they may have faith in you and receive the forgiveness, grace, and comfort that comes with knowing the risen Lord. We ask and pray all these things in the name of our risen Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. And may God add his blessing to the preaching of the word this day. We have an opportunity now to respond to God by bringing our tithes and offerings to him. And while our offering is uplifted, the choir are going to sing a piece for us.
Jesus, stand among us, and
just before we pray, I want to draw your attention again to this wee book that I highlighted a couple of weeks ago, looking at Jesus' resurrection and why Christians believe it. Someone has very kindly made four more copies of these available. So they will be at the front door if any of you are looking for one. I went to check the back door and I was delighted to see that they were all gone. So I'm really, really delighted that folks have been picking these up and going away and reading them. But if you missed an opportunity, there are another four copies for you to take away and to read. And if you do find it beneficial, please do bring it back and share them around with others in the congregation so we can all benefit from it. And thanks as well to those of you who have read it and come back to me and said you found it useful. I'm really grateful that you found it encouraging. Let us pray together. Lord Jesus, we ask and pray that your blessing would be upon the offering which has been received this day. We acknowledge, Lord God, that you call us to give ourselves to you in response to your love, grace, and forgiveness. May this offering be a tangible sign of our devotion to you, and may it be used and blessed by you in the spreading of the gospel to all who need to hear it. Lord Jesus, we are so grateful that you are present to us and that you walk with us through life. As we pray for others this day, we remember those who feel alone or rejected. We think especially of those who are elderly or isolated, who are suffering from a long-term illness and therefore are unable to get out and about, or those whose family circumstances mean that they feel as though no one is truly with them. We pray that they may see more clearly that they are loved by you, Lord God, and we lift them to you this day. Lord Jesus, we pray as well for those who are isolated and alone, but would really find a home here in your church. We ask that no one would look upon the fellowship that we have in the church with jealousy, but that they would feel called to come and share in the love and friendship that we experience by being part of the body of Christ. We pray as well that we as your people would also respond to your call to go and share your love with the world, and that all might know what it means to be loved by God. We pray you would help us in our task of sharing faith with other people. In a moment of silence, Heavenly Father, we lift before you our own personal prayers for others who are in need this day. Lord God, thank you that we can have confidence that whenever we pray, you are present to us because you walk with us through life. And so in that confidence, we lift all of our prayers for others to you this day, asking that you would intervene as you see fit and you would lead us, your people, to places of knowing where we can serve you by serving other people. We ask and pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Delighted that this morning we're going to welcome back the children who've been on holiday the last couple of weeks, and they're going to come and tell us a wee bit about what they have been learning in Sunday school today. Thank you. Well, good morning to the boys, girls, and leaders of our Sunday School Infusion. It's good to have you all back. Have you had a good holiday? Excellent. Glad to hear it. Are you all looking forward to being back at school tomorrow? Oh, you're not as sure about that one. Some of you said yes, some of you said no. Clearly, a few of your number are still needing a wee bit of time to prepare themselves for school because they're not here with us. They obviously need a rest. Now, you've been on holiday for the last couple of weeks. I wonder, what have you been up to? What are the things that you've done while you've been away on holiday? Can you have a think for me? What have you been doing? And then if you would like to share and tell us a wee bit about what you've been up to while you've been off, stick up your hand and you can let us know. Good, we've got a few folk want to tell us. What did you do on your holiday?
I went to the caravan and yesterday I got to build something.
Excellent. Do you remember what you got to build?
A bed.
A bed?
My bed.
You got to build your own bed yesterday. What a great way to spend a holiday, eh? Building your own bed. So we've had a caravan and someone building a bed. What else have we done on holiday? Sorry, I'll need to squeeze in. What have you done on your holiday?
Well, my friends were there.
Your friends were there? It's nice to hang out with your friends, isn't it, and have good fun with them. Yeah, we all like spending time with our friends. What else? We've got a couple more people with hands up. What did you do on your holidays?
We went to the beach.
You went to the beach. Was it sunny and warm?
No.
No? Was it dry?
Yes.
Oh, well, at least it was dry. Have you ever been to the beach in the rain?
No.
No. I'll tell you, it's great fun. You need to wrap up. Going to the beach is a great way. Can I squeeze out? Sorry. Anyone else want to tell me what they've done on their holiday? There's a few down the front now, so we'll make our way round. What did you do on your holidays?
I got my new kickboxing belt.
You got your new what?
Kickboxing belt.
What's that? Dare I ask? Kickboxing belt. Right. Sorry. That's fine. Which belt did you get?
Yellow.
Yellow. Fantastic. So it goes white, then yellow, doesn't it?
Well, not white, then yellow, white, red, then yellow.
So you're three steps up. Very well done. Excellently done. One last person. What did you do in your holidays?
I went to Tenerife.
You went to Tenerife? Did you have fun?
Yeah.
Excellent.
I went on the bungee jumping and I did backflips and forward flips.
You did backflips and forward flips? That sounds like great fun. You're still all in one piece, though. You didn't fall in... You still in one piece?
Yeah.
Good. Glad to hear it. Sounds like you've all had a really good time while you've been away. Now, I imagine you may not have had to do this, but your mums and dads or grannies and grandpas or whoever it was you were away with, they will probably have had to keep in touch with people, won't they? Especially if you were going away to different countries or whatever. Now, I wonder if you can think for me, what are the different things that we can use to keep in touch with people? There's different ways that we can keep in touch with people, okay? Have a wee think. How, if you wanted to get in touch with someone, how would you get in touch with them? Yes?
A phone.
A phone, yep. I've got one in my pocket here. You've got your phone. So you could text someone or you could give them a phone call, and that's one way to keep in touch with people. What other ways might we keep in touch with people? Yes.
You could be pen pals.
You could be pen pals, absolutely. You could write them a letter. Letter writing is a bit of a lost art in this day and age of instant communication, but very occasionally, myself and a few friends, we'll write each other letters because it's nice to spend some time thinking about the words that you want to send to someone. So we can use our phone, we can write a letter. What are some of the other ways that we can keep in touch with people?
A postcard.
A postcard. Especially one with, you know, the nice sunny beach that you're at to say, do you feel jealous? Ever had a postcard that said, wish you were here, and you get it and you think, aye, I really do wish I was there. You can get a postcard, pen pals, phone. There's a couple of other ways that we could keep in touch with people. Let's see if we can think about them. How would you keep in touch with someone?
An oven.
A what, sorry?
An oven.
An oven. How would you keep in touch with someone with an oven?
We could cook things.
You could cook things. So you might cook a meal for a friend and take it to them. Is that how you would do that then? Yes? Or you'd invite someone over to your house and you'd cook for them?
Yeah.
There you go. Food is a great way to keep in touch with people. I'm always saying if we want to run events in the church and get folk in, offer them food and they'll come in their droves. What other ways can we keep in touch with people? There's a couple more that I can think of. There's a hand up the back. We'll get that. I know you're keen, but you've already given an answer. How would you keep in touch with someone?
Just talk to them.
Just talk to them. What a lost art conversation is. You're right, you can just meet people and talk to them. So you could phone someone, you could write them a letter, send them a postcard, cook them a meal, talk to them. These are all great ways that we can keep in touch with people. A couple more I was thinking of, you could send emails or messages. Some of you, have you ever video called someone?
Yes.
On Skype or something like that? Those are great ways to keep in touch with people. Now, I know that in your story this morning, you were learning about Moses and how he was able to keep in touch with God and talk to God. Now, did Moses have to give God a phone call?
No.
No. Okay. Did he write God a letter?
No.
No. Did he FaceTime God? No. Then how did Moses keep in touch with God then? Did he have to do anything, or did he just get to come straight to God? You're very keen.
He had to go up a mountain to talk to him at the top.
I see. You're right. Moses did have to go up a mountain to talk to God. Does that mean we all need to go up a mountain to talk to God then?
Yeah.
Somebody says yes. That's fine. Church outing next Sunday, we'll go and climb, I don't know, Tinto's probably the nearest mountain. We don't have to climb a mountain to talk to God, do we? Does anyone know the word that we use for when we can talk to God? Yes?
Pray.
Pray. You're absolutely right. You see, God is with us wherever we are, and that means that we can talk to him whenever we need to. In the same way that Moses was able to just come and talk to God up the mountain, we can pray to God whenever we want. And we don't need to write him a letter or make a phone call or anything like that. So why don't we do that just now? Let's close our eyes and let's say a wee prayer to God. Lord God, we want to thank you that you are always with us and we can talk to you whenever we need to. We pray that you would help us be more aware of you in our lives. Help us, Lord God, to talk to you when we need to, and also to listen, because sometimes you will talk back to us. We pray all these things in the name of Jesus, who helps us to talk to you. Amen. Great to have you all back, as I said. It's wonderful, wonderful. We're going to bring our time together this morning to a close now. We're going to sing hymn number 448, Lord, the light of your love is shining. So let's stand and with gusto bring our time together to a close.
Jesus, light of the world, shine upon us, set us free by the truth.
from this place as witnesses of God's eternal presence. The risen Christ has made himself known to you, so set your faith and hope on God, fulfilling your call and commitment to live as a follower of Jesus in this world. And may the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit descend upon and dwell within your hearts this day, and be with you and those whom you love now and always.